गोपाल जीवारका जी, अनिल खेतान जी, राजीव तलवार जी, सौरभ सान्याल जी, मेंबर्स ऑफ द पीएचडी चेंबर, फ्रेंड्स, आई लाइक टू वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू हियर. आई एम ऑनर्ड टू बी स्पीकिंग टू द एस्टीम्ड मेंबर्स ऑफ द पीएचडी चेंबर ऑफ कॉमर्स. थैंक यू फॉर इनवाइटिंग मी हियर. I don't know the format. I'm giving a speech and then we are having a question and answer session. Is that? I'm okay with whatever you want. I'm here to oblige.
I think we'll be more than happy to do that. We'll be more than happy to have question answers. It'd be a great privilege.
Okay. Whatever you prefer. Anyway, I'll quickly go through my speech. A little over 3 years ago, Mr. Narendra Modi was given a tremendous honor by our country. Many of our people reposed their faith in him. Many Indian people believed that he had the ability and understanding to develop and implement a vision for the coming decade. They expected an Indian vision. Today, it is fair to say that that expectation lies shattered. I remember Mr. Narendra Modi's first speech to Parliament. Even I, as a Lok Sabha member, was curious. I wanted to know what the new Prime Minister was going to say. I wanted to understand what he would lay out as the vision going forward. And as he wound his way through his long speech, going on about Sikkim, about organic farming, it went on and on and on. And in the middle of the speech, a colleague of mine nudged me. And he came and he whispered in my ear, "There's nothing here." The speech was full of taglines. Lab to land, real-time data, soil health cards. But as we walked away from there, and this was a large number of us, there was a sense of disappointment. We had expected a concrete way forward, and we had expected that we would be given something that we could challenge. In fact, when we went there, I must tell you, we expected our Prime Minister to bowl us over. And I came away happy in one way and quite upset in another. I came away happy because I felt that we would have a good shot at challenging the Prime Minister. And I felt upset because I felt that India deserved a solid vision, and it didn't get one that day. But what really disturbed me that day, and I mentioned it to some of the guys who sit with us, was the condescending tone that ran through his entire speech like a thread. And that tone has embedded itself in the psyche of this government, and it has become the bedrock of its immense arrogance. Business thrives with trust. Every single big business transaction is a transaction of trust. Trust is what you deal in. From trust emerges a safe and predictable environment. Business is about bringing people together, about creating harmony, about creating trust and competition. And the truth is, and I say this as an opposition member, but it is being said by many people who are not in the opposition, that the trust in this government is dead. For some reason, the PM and his government are absolutely convinced that every single person in India is a thief. Trust goes two ways. The government does not believe in its people. And now, after 3 years, after trying again and again and again, slowly, the people have withdrawn their trust from the government. How does one develop trust? Only by listening. The only way trust comes is if you listen to each other. Can't be done otherwise. But today there is no one in the government ready to listen to the pain of our people. Globally, India is being asked again and again if it still believes in its values of compassion and non-violence. People once looked up to us for our values and leadership. Today they laugh as we are busy debating whether one of the 7 wonders of the world, the Taj Mahal, was actually built by Indians. In a couple of weeks from now, we will observe the death anniversary of the 500 and 1,000 rupee note. November the 8th is the barsi of note bandi. A day when Sri Narendra Modi personally wiped out 86% of the currency in circulation overnight. It was a move taken without thought, without consultation, or concern for its consequences. The Prime Minister failed to grasp a basic concept of the Indian economy, the most fundamental concept. All cash is not black, and all black is not cash. Without understanding this basic concept, the Prime Minister used his vast powers to unleash terror on the citizens of India. To make millions of Indian citizens stand in queues for over 2 months, desperately running from one ATM to another, many of them dying in the process, millions losing their jobs and their livelihood. To do all that, you surely need someone with a very big chest, but a very small heart. Demonetization crippled SMEs and has destroyed the unorganized sector, forcing workers to leave urban employment and go back to their villages, searching for MNREGA work. And now GST, or Gabbar Singh tax, a tax so badly conceptualized and implemented that is only adding to the distrust. Their GST is wrecked with holes, moth-eaten, flawed in its structure, punitive in its design, and it is forcing businesses to incur massive transaction costs that are destroying them. It is creating a 21st century computerized and connected license raj. GST, as this government has formulated it, has already unleashed a tsunami of tax terrorism, and it is only going to get worse. Small, micro, and medium businesses are screaming in pain. They are drowning. And Mr. Arun Jaitley, with his impeccable logic, has the nerve to go on TV every other day and tell people that things are just fine. The government simply refuses to listen. Everybody is shouting. Every other day you see Mr. Jaitley, everything is okay, and he pulls out a graph and shows us that after 2019, things will become normal again. The way this regime is working, or not working, shall we say, has led to a double tap killing of the Indian economy. Commandos in hostage situations fire what is called a double tap. Two quick, closely placed shots fired at the chest to ensure that their terrorist target is down. is dead. Modi ji and his government have fired a double tap at the heart of our economy. First note bandi, bang, and then GST, bang, has crippled our economy. And it continues. The situation of joblessness in the country is extremely worrying. The government is creating a massive army of unemployed youth, which is toxic and dangerous. Instead of admitting they cannot and are not providing jobs, they are riling communities up against each other in a bloody rage. As we all know, GDP growth has been slowing. Private investment has collapsed. Agricultural growth is at its lowest ebb. Exports have been declining. In 2014, India's GDP was growing at 6.6%. But today, according to the new way of measuring GDP, India stands at 4.2%. Not only are insufficient numbers of jobs being created, real wages have been stagnant for 3 years. Indian citizens cannot meet their basic expenses, leave alone spend on consumption that is required to boost our economy. Bank lending is at the lowest level in 60 years. Investment at a 15-year low, power generation at a decade low, and unemployment skyrockets. And as if this was not enough, recent research by respected economists has shown that inequality in India is now at its highest level in 100 years. We are staring at a disaster. I'm not talking of technology making jobs redundant, as is happening in the West. This is a pure man-made disaster, or in Modi-ji's terminology, an MMD, a Modi-made disaster. Ladies and gentlemen, despite the current mess in the economy, what I want to say here today is that the Indian economy can be revived. Under the UPA regime, between 2004 and 2011, 140 million people came out of poverty. That is 20 million people every year. For the first time in our history, for the first time ever, if it is steered correctly and faithfully, India has the opportunity to wipe out poverty forever. If India is able to lift another 350 million people out of poverty by 2030, it would be an achievement that the entire human race can be proud of. Doing this would require us to grow by more than 8% in the next 13 years. And this is the challenge. India has done it before, and we can do it again. However, no amount of growth is enough for India if it is not accompanied by the creation of jobs. It does not matter how much you grow, how fast you grow. If you are not creating jobs, you are not solving the problem. We are a nation of small, micro, and medium businesses. Nearly 6 crore of these enterprises are engaged in business in our country. You're the backbone, but you get very little support. These businesses are India's traditional network. These networks have been with us for thousands of years. They represent our nation's innovative capabilities, our knowledge, and our vast understanding. These networks are situated in thousands of clusters around the country. They are rich with knowledge and skill and make up the heart of our country's economic legacy. We need targeted cluster development programs at a massive scale across the country. It is this reservoir of skill and innovation that needs to be unlocked and freed from the oppressive and unpredictable bureaucratic red tape it faces every single day. Let us start by accepting a simple reality that China outperforms us in the creation of jobs. China creates 50,000 jobs every single day. India is currently creating 450. Let me repeat that. China creates 50,000 jobs every single day. India is creating 450. And let me be very clear. The only force capable of meeting the Chinese challenge is the network of small, micro, and medium businesses. Nobody else. Nobody else can do this job. And I have no doubt in my mind that you are the only force that has the skills, the knowledge, and the understanding to take on the Chinese and to beat them at their own game. Today, the national discussion is only about growth. India can no longer carry on without a clear focus and strategy on the creation of jobs. How are we going to create jobs? That is the central question in front of this country today. We need to link these small, micro, and medium businesses to our banking system. We need to infuse them with credit and create a completely new deal for these businesses in finance. Today, they receive almost no bank credit, even though they account for 40% of India's economic output and half of our exports. More importantly, they account for 80% of all non-agricultural employment. Yet all SMEs combined get as much credit from banks as the 10 largest companies in India. Even though this money generates 30 times more employment, the truth is, even yesterday's bank recapitalization announcement, because it's only an announcement, targets only India's biggest businesses while throwing crumbs at MSMEs. Imagine how much employment we could create if we actually made capital available to you in the same way that we do for the biggest companies in this country. We urgently need to give these networks access to the political system, the same access that big business already enjoys. You too need to be heard in the corridors of power. You have been blasted by Modi's lethal double tap. My question is, why is the government treating their most powerful weapon in the fight against unemployment without dignity? Why does the government disrespect small and medium businesses and treat them like thieves? They must stop painting you as evil and must seek your cooperation in rebooting our economy. Startup India is welcome for the economy, but it cannot be accompanied by Shut Up India. What gives Startup India its strength is freedom of expression, thought, and dissent. You choke this, and you choke entrepreneurship. You're the source of this nation's creative and entrepreneurial energy. It is the imperative of those in government to listen to your voice, whoever they may be. I'm here today to say we trust you. We believe in you. We understand the terror you feel at the unpredictable nature of this new computerized license raj. Your struggles are the struggles of this nation. Your pride is our pride. Your growth and well-being is the growth and well-being of each one of us. And the Congress Party will always support you. It will always have the humility to listen to your voices, and it will stand shoulder to shoulder with you as you build the foundations of a resurgent India. Thank you.
I think this is a great privilege that not only have you come here, spoken from the heart, but also given us the opportunity to ask questions. So taking you up on that, the first question is from the president of PhD Chamber, Mr. Gopal Jivarajka ji. Would you please? I think as you are comfortable, this is fine.
Rahul ji, since aap jyada sawal nahi log hain, hum ek hi sawal mein thode jyada pooch lete hain. Pehla hai ki aapne abhi kaha ki we trust you. Sir, सब सरकारें कहती हैं कि वी ट्रस्ट यू, पर लेकिन जो कानून और नीतियां बनती हैं वो मिसट्रस्ट पे होती हैं. एंड देयरफॉर ऑल द लॉज गेट सो कॉम्प्लेक्स दैट एक्चुअली दे वर्क आउट टू बी एंटी ऑनेस्ट एंड प्रो डिसऑनेस्ट. सो फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज हाउ वुड यू if you were to, your government would to come, was to come and make policies, how would you tackle that? My second question is, so for 2 years, the Congress...
Can I answer that?
Yes, please.
I'll stand up and answer that. I'm more comfortable standing up. So I think the main issue politically in India is access of the political institution. If you look at the Lok Sabha and the Vidhan Sabhas, for all practical purposes, these institutions, they are designed to make laws. They are designed to be open platforms with which you can communicate, and they are designed to make laws. So the first step, actually, is a decentralization of power and a opening up of power and allowing you to access it. That's the first step. My analysis of what is going wrong today is absolute concentration of power in the Prime Minister's office, absolute concentration of power in the Chief Minister's office. And when you have absolute concentration of power in the Prime Minister's office, it is much more difficult for all of you to access the Prime Minister's office than it is for the 10, 15 biggest businesses. So that is my understanding. So the biggest step that you can take is decentralize power and create platforms, political platforms, legislative platforms with which you can communicate. That's how I think about it.
So my second point is that for 2 years, the Congress...
Sorry, one last thing. Sorry, but also, and I've learned this over the last 10 years, listening is a very, very powerful tool in India. In fact, it overrides pretty much everything. If you go with an open mind and you go without anger or without preconceived notions and you listen, a lot of the answers are just waiting to be picked up. So that, to me, a government has to view itself as a listening system, and it has to operate as a process. Now, for example, it's pretty clear that the GST has gone wrong. The response of the government should be, okay, something has gone wrong, let's start a conversation on how we can quickly fix it. But the response and the attitude of the government is, no, we have now stuck our neck out, we've decided that this is what it is going to be, and we are going to implement this. And then you have an accident. So the humility to accept that you can also go wrong is a very powerful thing.
Sir, two questions, quick ones. One is on GST. For 2 years, the Congress argued in the parliament that the capping of the rate should be put in the bill. What circumstances made you give up this stance? And second one is, Sir, Aadhaar. This was originated in the UPA time, and the whole architecture and the backbone of Aadhaar was of a voluntary nature of disclosure. Today, everything is becoming mandatory, and I think we have a huge disaster looming because the architecture was never built for something which it is being used today.
Absolutely.
And why is the opposition not screaming from the roofs that this is going to be a disaster?
You know, we I must tell you, we fought a very brave battle, the Congress party, to get India a GST that was workable. And the basic architecture of that was minimum slabs, a cap on the amount of tax, and a simple GST. And Randeep ji is here smiling, but we gave it everything we had. Somewhere down the line, when it came close to making that decision, and we sent many messages. We sent Chidambaram ji to Mr. Arun Jaitley and said, you guys are making a mistake. I mean, this is not a Congress BJP thing. You guys are now making a mistake with the country's economy. And we got a response saying, frankly, to put it bluntly, mind your own business. Right? You guys, mind your own business. And so, at a certain point, we decided, okay, the country wants a GST. We have placed on the table what our GST looks like. We have fought to defend it. But now the country wants a GST, and so we let it go. By the way, internally we also knew that the GST had to be put in slowly. So even after we had sort of decided, okay, we are going to support, we again sent Mr. Chidambaram and others to Mr. Jaitley and said, whatever you do, please run it on a pilot basis. Run it for 3 or 4 months, check what is going on, and then expand it out. And again, we were told, guys, mind your own business. So we said, okay, go ahead. Again, the, you know, in my speech, I'm a Congress person, but I'm also, and before a Congress person, I'm an Indian person. I believe that no matter who you're dealing with, if you're a political person, you have to start with the idea of trust. I don't even like you, I still have to say, okay, I'm going to start by giving you benefit of doubt. And that was the design of the Aadhaar program. The Aadhaar program was designed to be a supporting mechanism, not to be a monitoring mechanism. And the forces that are in power today are converting it into a monitoring mechanism. That's how they visualize Aadhaar. That's just not how Aadhaar was intended. And I agree with you. It is going to have serious consequences, and also it's not going to be workable. So you will end up in the same mess that you are now with GST. You will attempt to do something that is not feasible, and then you will get stuck.
Thank you for a very heartening speech. It's very good to hear from your own speech itself that this community is important in your whole scheme of things. Now, assuming that you do come back to power in 2019, could you give us insight into your thinking, how trade, commerce, and industry will be revived? Few things that your government would do to make sure that we can contribute to the nation building in the spirit that we need to, and create employment generation, because India is getting 1 million youth a month. And currently there's very dismal statistics, as you yourself pointed out, because the current sarkar to aapne bahut dara diya hai unko, suit boot ki sarkar bol ke. So hum log to paraye hain unke liye. Thank you.
First of all, every single community in India, big business, small business, farmers, everybody is a system. So to say that we are for this one group and not for this other group just doesn't make sense. You have to view India as a composite system that is running, and you need to balance that system. So there will be times when you need to support someone extra, and then there will be times when you can reduce that support. And it's a dynamic process. I think, as I mentioned, India has tremendous traditional skills hidden in thousands of clusters around the country. Those skills do not have access to money, they do not have access to the government system. So providing financial support, providing governance support to those clusters, and unlocking each one of those clusters. In a roundabout way, if you look in detail at what the Chinese have done, that is actually what they have done. And so we cannot discount our traditional knowledge system. And you are the people who represent that system. Make in India for me is not a top-down exercise where you take all defense contracts and you hand them to certain players. Make in India for me is a bottom-up exercise where you create competition among thousands of you to create the big companies of tomorrow. So it's a bottom-up process. That would be central. To me, the biggest discrepancy I see, and again I mentioned it there, is you're the people creating the jobs, but you're not the people getting the financial support. So that one thing absolutely has to be corrected. And I don't know, I mean, I don't want to take names, but the minister of small and medium businesses should be a fundamental pillar in the government. I think you are seen not as a central part of the strategy for the creation of jobs. Today you are seen as, you know, apart from that. The Congress would attempt to make you the central pillar of a job strategy for the nation. That's the difference. And a lot of it comes by how you position it. I learned this from the Prime Minister, by the way. How you sort of signal. And I think a lot of the signaling that we will do is that we value you, and you're going to have the full support of the government, because we believe that if jobs are going to be created in India, you are going to create them.
Rahul ji, आपने एक बहुत ही अच्छी और सच्ची बात कही कि इस सरकार में सब कुछ पावर पीएमओ के पास ही केंद्रित है, लेकिन जब यूपीए की सरकार आई थी तब भी सेम पोजीशन होती थी, जब सारी पावर 10 जनपद पर थी.
नहीं, 10 जनपद पर नहीं थी, दैट इज अ मिसअंडरस्टैंडिंग. बट That is a misunderstanding. Das Janpat mein nahi thi. And also the concentration of the PMO was nowhere near the concentration of power in the PMO today. I mean, we speak to ministers in the BJP government. Even ministers like Sushma Swaraj ji and others don't have power in this government. Only the Prime Minister has power in this government. That is something fundamental to understand. It's completely different than the way Congress runs its government. I'm also not saying that in its last 2 or 3 years, the Congress was running an exceptional government. I'm admitting that there were shortcomings in our government towards its closing days. But I would say that a new government of the Congress party would be a much more decentralized government. It would be a government that distributes power much more than even the last Congress government.
Sir, आपने अभी गब्बर सिंह टैक्स के बारे में बात करी है, तो इसका जो स्लैब है,
नाम आपको अच्छा लगा?
बहुत अच्छा है, क्योंकि वाकई टैक्स की तरह ही भुगत रहे हम लोग रोज.
ये सच्चाई है एक्चुअली. ये
इसीलिए मैं आपसे एक्सप्लेन जा रहा हूँ कि अगर आप वाकई गब्बर सिंह टैक्सेस को मानते हैं तो इसको 28% स्लैब जो है, 35%, इसके लिए आप पार्टी की तरफ से कोई कुछ नहीं, कोशिश क्यों नहीं करते? इसको शुरुआत करें, हम आपके साथ खड़े.
हमारी जो पोजीशन थी वो हमने बहुत क्लियरली देश को, बीजेपी सरकार को, प्रधानमंत्री को, चिदम्बरम जी ने, जेटली जी को क्लियरली बताया. हमारी पोजीशन है कि ये जो GST बनी है ये ओवर कॉम्प्लिकेटेड है. ये जो 5-6 टैक्स के स्लैब्स बनाए हैं इसमें कमियां हैं, और जो 28% का टैक्स है वो 18% पर कैप होना चाहिए. दुख की बात है कि अब GST लागू हो गई है, तो अब उस प्रकार के चेंजेस करना शायद ये सरकार एक्सेप्ट नहीं करेगी. मगर हमारी पोजीशन, और हम दबाव डालेंगे और डाल रहे हैं, मगर हमारी पोजीशन है कि GST को रिफॉर्म करना ही पड़ेगा, GST को बदलना पड़ेगा और GST को सिंप्लीफाई करना पड़ेगा.
विजेंद्र सिंह, मैं कुछ पूछ सकता हूं प्लीज? राहुल भाई, इससे पहले मेरा भी सेशन था यहां पे, मैं स्पोर्ट्स डेवलपमेंट के ऊपर बात हो रही थी, तो मैंने कभी आज तक कोई भी मेंबर ऑफ पार्लियामेंट या MLA कभी भी कोई स्पोर्ट्स खेलते हुए नहीं देखा. मैंने रिबन काटते बहुत लोगों को देखा है, लेकिन नेवर सीन अ सिंगल MLA और MP इन इंडिया कि वो कोई भी स्पोर्ट्स में का. हाँ, मैंने देखा बहुत सारे सेलिब्रिटीज आते हैं, जाते फुटबॉल मैच खेल लिया, क्रिकेट मैच खेल लिया, दैट्स फाइन. बट अगर आप प्रधानमंत्री बनते हैं तो आपके स्पोर्ट्स डेवलपमेंट के ऊपर क्या थॉट्स होंगे? आप स्पोर्ट्स डेवलपमेंट इंडिया में आपको लेके आना, तो आप क्या करेंगे उस चीज़ के लिए? नंबर वन. नंबर टू, मैं और मेरी वाइफ हमेशा बात करते कि राहुल भैया कब शादी करेंगे. मैंने बोला कि प्रधानमंत्री बन के शादी करके जाएंगे तब कहते मजा ही अलग होता
है। वाला क्वेश्चन वो बहुत पुराना क्वेश्चन है।
नहीं पर प्लीज उसका जवाब तो दे दीजिए प्लीज सर। सब लोग उसका वेट ही कर रहे हैं तब से लेके हम भी सब लोग।
मैं डेस्टिनी में बिलीव करता हूँ, जब होगी होगी। बट जो अच्छा जो आपने स्पोर्ट्स के बारे में बोला है
सर,
उसमें मैं तो इंक्लूडेड नहीं हूं, क्योंकि मैं एक्सरसाइज करता हूं, रनिंग करता हूं, स्विमिंग करता हूं। मैं पता नहीं आपको आइकिडो का नाम आपने सुना है, उसमें मैं ब्लैक बेल्ट हूं। तो मैं करता रहता हूं। बस एक बात है, मैं पब्लिकली इन चीजों के बारे में नहीं बोलता, मगर मेरी जिंदगी में स्पोर्ट्स काफी जरूरी है, रहा है और रहेगा। नॉर्मली मैं 1 घंटा स्पोर्ट्स कम से कम रोज करता हूं। ये बात जरूर है कि पिछले 3-4 महीने के लिए मैंने नहीं किया है, बट उससे पहले पूरी जिंदगी मैंने कम से कम 1 घंटा स्पोर्ट्स तो किया है।
बट सर उसका भी वीडियो डालिए कुछ, कोई भी एक्टिविटीज करते हुए, बिकॉज तब से ही तभी लोग उसको देखेंगे और उनको इंस्पिरेशन आ गया कि लग राहुल सर कर सकते हैं, हम क्यों नहीं कर सकते, राइट? तो वो भी बिकॉज पार्लियामेंट के सर हम आपकी बॉक्सिंग रेसलिंग सब देखते हो, दैट्स फाइन, वो ठीक है, लेकिन स्पोर्ट्स करते वक्त भी एक दो वीडियो और डाल दे तो
okay, डाल देंगे I'll put
तो आपकी बॉक्सिंग आपके मैदान में।
I'll just take one last one ma'am, excuse me।
अच्छा लास्ट क्वेश्चन
राहुल जी सर,
this is exactly where I was getting to.
ये तो आपको इलेक्शन कमीशन से पूछना पड़ेगा। ये भैया इससे रेलेवेंट सवाल नहीं है।
राहुल जी
सॉरी
हाय, as you can see in this entire hall, you'll find a lot of people with gray hair, specs.
Including me.
No, you're young.
Little bit here.
No, you still carry those dimples, so that's amazing. And you're quite fit. I saw you the other day on television wearing a t-shirt and I could see those arms. See, the thing is, in your government, in the Congress government, in UPA 2, we did see a lot of young faces as cabinet ministers. Jitin Prasad, Jyotiraditya Scindia, Sachin Pilot. Unfortunately, we don't see it here in the present dispensation. Young leaders, young politicians. I think it is very important to change the narrative. You know, when we have to get done with the old, come in with the new. It was high time that a young leader took charge. My request is, in future, when you do get an opportunity to build the nation, youth should play a very, very significant role in that.
Yeah.
So, and I represent the youth over here. I'm just 34 years old, but a businessman. So my request is, please take the youth along with you.
I think I agree with you that we certainly had more younger faces. I think we should have more younger faces than we did. And I'm sure any Congress government in the future will be a much younger government. But there is also, I must say, value to experience. There is value to experience. So, no, you have to have, you know, I've dealt with a Manmohan Singh ji or a Mr. Chidambaram or a Pranab Mukherjee. There is a very important value to somebody who has spent a long time looking at these processes. So I think even though we will have a large majority of people who are younger, we will also take support of our traditional wisdom, which is there.
Well, you're absolutely right about the value.
I just want to answer that last thing about education. There is a belief, and this is very evident in Gujarat, where I have spoken and I've gone into a bit of detail. There is a belief that privatization, that a private education system
is the answer. And a lot of privatization has been done of the university system, of the college system in Gujarat. And what has resulted is a disaster. What you need is a balanced system where there is a public sector education system of high quality that creates a competitive atmosphere for the private system. I think we have some very, very good institutions in this country. I think the IITs, the IIMs are extremely good institutions, but we have to think about them as knowledge systems. We have to open them up and we have to transform them into knowledge networks, which are connected to the rest of the country and to the rest of the world. So I think we have, with regards to education, we have the foundation, but there is a lot of interesting work that we can do. We need to think internationally. We need to think how we connect these structures to the rest of the world. But I'm confident that we have the seeds of the best education system in the world. That would be my answer. I would like to thank all of you. It's been a pleasure for me to come here and speak to you, take your questions. Abhaya.
You mentioned that there's a wealth of experience which has to be appreciated. Yeah. And I have to say, we totally appreciate the experience of having you here with us.
Thank you.